Good morning. Sorry, these webinars have been in the morning previously. Good afternoon, everybody. Again, thank you for your patience managing the rescheduling of this webinar. My name is Melanie Arthur. For those of you that I haven't met yet, I'm pleased to be doing this webinar series with Northwest Central Illinois and NCI Works. Today, we're going to be talking about advancing services to businesses. And while this may or may not be true for everybody, and it's certainly you may be somewhere on a continuum, I'm really going to talk about the business community as a separate and distinct customer, in addition to our approach to businesses and relationship to help our youth and our adults and our dislocated workers and our job seekers and our unemployment insurance claimants and our veterans get jobs. So that is one sort of driving approach to businesses, but I'm going to kind of talk about them or encourage us to really think about them as a separate and distinct customer group. So there's a combination of reasons why I'm pointing that out. One is really to give you some tips and tools, and also to really make sure we're taking their position and looking into our system as much as possible. So it's not just a placement of our program participants. It's really about developing relationships and having in mind the distinction and certainly maybe the goal of having business partners, not just business customers. So really the most kind of highest level relationship you can get with businesses is a win-win for everybody, yourself, your programs, your customers, your business, your community, the economy. So really thinking about businesses as partners, also as customers, but making your relationship with them one of the keys that we're focused on. We have going to overview and discuss five topics here. This is a selection of possible topics that we could have had at a webinar. They're not necessarily related, but we're going to have a little bit of a conversation, more in depth or more brief, depending on which, on each of these five topics. So really updating folks for what is distinct about how businesses are treated and addressed and related to within the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act. And let me say in advance, I'm definitely guilty of a lot of shortcutting here. So I'm assuming everybody on this call knows what WIOA stands for, the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act. But just in case you don't, or if you ever use this recorded archived webinar for new staff, I want to make sure I do a pretty good job slowing down and not being too government speak or too rich in my acronyms. And folks, certainly when you're jumping into the conversation, if I've said something that's not understandable, be sure to slow me down. So in addition to the themes within Workforce Innovation Opportunity Act, one of the main ones is sector strategy. So we're going to talk about that and how it really is a very much an umbrella strategy that we can use to organize a number of things, our services, our targeting employers. We can use sector strategies to really customize our employment and training programs. So I'll be showing you throughout this webinar different methods for doing that or doing more of that, assuming you have some of this alignment already put in place. For the first time, especially for the Title I-B program, so the legislation's written in titles. The first title is one. Section B in Title I talks about the adult dislocated worker and youth programs. We used to refer to these as WIA programs, but WIA was a piece of legislation under which these programs fell. So there was a fair amount of restriction, both formally and informally, to really focusing distinctly and separately on business services other than as a means to meet your performance measures around placement and enter and rate and retention. In this piece of legislation, business services are required to be delivered and developed and delivered by local boards. So we'll, especially a basic group, and then you have opportunity to expand that list of business services. So we're going to talk about what that means and what it looks like and what the options you have. And let me just say, by virtue of talking about partnerships here, that there are two sections. There's one piece of legislation called the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act, and there's two packages of regulations. They're separated into accounts. And there's one package of regulations under which talk about things that apply to all of the core program partners in the system. And then there's a separate package of regulations that's just related to Department of Labor programs. So the discussion of business services and the content around business services actually falls in the piece of regulation that's called the joint rule. So it's describing business services and the requirement to have business services as a system activity. It's that piece of regulation talks to all of the core program partners at the same time. So when we look at this list of WIOA business services, it is saying all four of the core programs, all six of the core programs, all four of the core partners and all six of the core programs are pointed in this direction with the flexibility to do expanded business services. So I just wanted to put that placeholder in place. We're talking really about you and all your part together if you choose to expand and enhance that. One of the other key strategies really featured in the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act is work-based training. Some of you have been following along this series of webinars. Certainly, my friend Diana, you know we've been talking about this with the board. Your board is really on board with this strategic option for investing training dollars. And so we'll talk some detail about what it says in the legislation, what's required, and then beyond that, what your opportunities are. And one of the keys for work-based training and why it's one of the topics we'll talk about here is it really makes the business a partner. When you're talking about work-based training, you're actually contracting with the employer to be the trainer. So it really expands that definition of customer all the way to partner and how it is we work with businesses to expand work-based training options and make it really a viable strategy for you and for them and especially for customers who may benefit from this version of training. There is a new requirement in the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act for a business employer performance measure. And the final regulations that came out just a few weeks ago talk about, it's not set in stone. They have three ideas about how they're going to measure it, and they're going to pilot and give states some opportunity to experience these measures and then study the state's experience and then finalize it. But I wanted you to make sure you understood what they think of when they're talking about a measure, a performance measure for business engagement and business customers. So we'll take a look at that very briefly. And then also at the end, also another just a brief opportunity to talk about outreach strategies and tips. I'm drawing from, I do a lot of training around the country on business services with business teams and business representatives. So I'm drawing from my catalog of training programs, all of which are at least a day-long classroom. So I'm just drawing a couple of ideas from out of those very comprehensive training programs just to give you guys a few strategies and tips that you might be able to use as you start to expand business services and maybe increase your partnering with the private sector, public sector partners to build business service teams. So that's the discussion topics for today. After each session, I'll be sure to stop and kind of put the mics open and see what kind of discussion. So jot down your questions. You can store them in the chat box, although it's hard for me to keep monitoring that, but you can also jot them down there. So I think the mics are still open. Any questions on the agenda? Does anybody have any questions on the agenda? Does it sound good?
Sounds good.
Okay. So let me start with kind of my broad take on how I describe the roles for staff people who are business representatives. So not just working with businesses on behalf of a program, but really they are business representatives. I describe them as, myself and those of us on the Greg Newton team, describe them as four distinct roles. So I want you to think about these roles. I want you to think about which ones of these roles you currently include in how you define your task and responsibility for your program, and how each of these roles really describe kind of a macro level way of perhaps coming together as a team and sharing the responsibility to make sure all four of these roles are covered. So it might be that there are some of you that are good business consultants and some of you are maybe business service providers. Again, there's an opportunity really to think of yourself as working together across the system so that more businesses know who you are and choose to work with you. So the business consultant role is really about your knowledge and sharing your knowledge and your expertise. It's about connecting businesses with critical data on the economy, data on the workforce, data that is relevant to their ability to be successful in their work. And it's your role in sharing the strategies around workforce development with businesses. So to the extent, for example, you think of yourself as a human resource person and a human resource consultant, that's the role that I kind of put this under this umbrella called business consultant. And it's a role that really doesn't have, it's a relationship building role. It's not something that we count in relationship to service delivery, making sure that businesses have access to whatever they need out of the public sector in order to be successful. Is not something that pops up on a quick sheet where we're counting services, but it's a very critical role in your ability to develop not only customership, but partnership with employer. So the business champion role is one that I do see business reps do off and on, and this is really because you are out in the business community, you have your ear to the business customer, bringing the business customer's needs into the center and aligning the center around those needs. And let me just give you my favorite example of this. And again, I know this is true in your area, but it's a good example of what I mean. So every year, the process of recruiting and hiring changes, and some years more significantly than others. And we had a brief conversation about this with Al from IDES in your area on a different webinar. But businesses are changing the way they recruit and hire workers. And you being knowledgeable of that means you need to come in on a regular basis, for example, and look at the workshops you're delivering to your job seekers, either people who just finished training or people who are only job seekers without having gone to training, and see if our workshops are current. So, for example, making sure, again, and this is a perennial problem, making sure that all job seekers really understand the impact of their presence in social media has. Employers are almost 100% in within the hiring process going onto the social media sites and finding workers. And each year, the number of workers that lose the opportunity for a job goes up because employers are more rigorous about doing this research online. And using social media as a tool in their job. So how to use LinkedIn as a good source for job hunting is probably a good title for a workshop, not just a networking workshop, but really using that, making sure people understand there's no such thing as having one resume, but really they need a different resume for each job. Employers now are very likely to be creating in-house pools of resumes and using in-house employees for the search for new employees. So this relationship to networking has gone up. So these are examples of being a business champion, knowing how the world of business works, especially around recruiting and hiring, bringing those practices in, teaching your colleagues about what's current, how businesses do recruiting and hiring, and then making sure our products and services, especially our information on our workshops, are aligned. So that's the second one of the second key roles that I recommend that business representatives are covering. The third is really the connector. This is the navigator. This is making sure that no matter what a business needs, especially from the public entities that are your partners, that you connect them to them. So I'm sure this has never happened, and I hope you like a little bit of sarcasm. I'm sure this has never happened in North Central Illinois, but employers sometimes call into our systems and say, into our offices, our centers, our program provider phone numbers, and they say things like, I've tried everything, so now I'm calling you. Not only does that not make you the first stop, it makes you the last stop, common with some desperation added in. I'm sure most of you have never had that kind of phone call before. But what you want employers, the goal of this role is what you want employers to say is, I don't know if you're the right person to call, but you were so helpful last time. Can you point me in the right direction? So making sure the businesses understand tax credits and have access to any small business administration opportunities and are connected to your strategy or your sector strategies and have the posters they need to hang on the wall that are required by equal opportunity, for example, in wage and hour and ocean safety. It's really connecting businesses to all of the pieces of government that they need to be connected to in order to be successful. So you would really have to be knowledgeable and you'd have to have good navigator skills to be a business connector, which is role number three. And then role number four, almost everybody does, and they do pretty naturally, and that is to provide services to the business community and to different employers. So this is whatever your list of services that are, especially in relationship to working with businesses, that's you actually being in the position of delivering that service to the business. So the service provider role, I'm applying not just to entities, but to you as individuals in relationship to the title business representative. So this is my version of talking about the four business roles, and I like to use them as an umbrella description. And then as we move through the conversation today, I can connect them to, this is really when you're being a business connector, or this is when you're being a business champion or business consultant. So let me just stop and ask people, how do you see yourself in all four of these? Do you like this description of the four roles? What do people think about this opening slide here?
Melanie?
Yes.
Okay, it's Diana. Yes. We've actually had an interagency business services team probably since about 2004, and if Pam's online and knows the exact date, that would really help me out. But and that is, we followed the model actually that Greg Newton was just so excited about at the very beginning of the Workforce Investment Act, that actually those four roles are the roles that we have historically since the early 2000s been trying to perfect. And I think recently our focus has turned more onto business champion, and historically maybe we've spent more time in 1, 3, and 4, but recently we've really tried to take off in the business champion area with a number of initiatives that we've been trying to do.
Events and activities. Excellent. Well, I know you do a lot. I'm so pleased to hear this. So maybe this is just kind of a moment in time where we step back and take that macro look at ourselves and do just what you did. Okay, so I see us doing a lot here, we do less there, maybe we need more here. And certainly making sure that you think about yourself in a planning way to make sure you don't have to do all four all the time, but you may want to have some priority activities in each of them so that you're keeping up on all of them. Excellent. I'm pleased to see that. I'm surprised I didn't know you were using this model already, but thanks for throwing that in there. All right, so then we won't spend too much more time on that. Let's just do a brief review. Again, if you've been following along with this webinar series, I know especially some of the BESTINC staff have been doing it. So I just want to put the sector strategies and share knowledge about sector strategies across your interagency team. So this is really both your consultant role and your connector role. And I think as sector strategies continue to be enhanced and further developed in North Central Illinois, Northwest Central Illinois, your role can be more specific. How it is you consult with employers on the availability of a sector strategy if it relates to the industry that they work in, or connect them to sector strategy activities. I think there's also an opportunity for you to be connected to the strategic partner lead. So sector strategies don't always come out of the Title I-B programs, but they do come out of the board. So really figuring out how to be attached to the lead in the sector strategy and finding key ways to be the organizers and the facilitators and certainly the participants in fleshing out and developing all of the many, many, many details that come out of this massive umbrella strategy. So you want to make sure you're part of the organizers, facilitators, and have a big role in participating. So sector strategies are where you have a very intense focus on a specific industry over a pretty intensive piece of time. You're customizing solution for that sector, and you really want to have system change at a very macro level with talent pipelines and career pathways and specifically optimize education and training opportunities. So it's really a group of individuals from business, organized labor, the public sector, economic development, education and training, community-based organizations. It's really a measure of all legs of the community coming together and working together to address chronic long-term issues that are preventing future issues, I mean looking forward, that are preventing success. And I know in your area of the region, your sectors are being targeted by region, but they include, if I can remember, manufacturing, healthcare, and logistics. So those three sectors will have a strategy that will help any employer in that sector advance. And what they've discovered over seeding and experimenting and doing R&D on sector strategy over the last 15 years, lots of grants have gone out to jumpstart and to grease the wheels for these. They really turn into a wealth creation generators, and so they do have measurable economic development impact. The investment really the return exceeds the investment, but it's a lot of man and woman power. It's a lot of staff hours to get one of these up and running and churning out some good outcomes. It really aids all components. So the workers, the employers, educators and trainers, the public sector service providers, a sector strategy floats that whole boat. So it's why it's legislated into the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act. It's not something they're recommending. It's something they're required that your sectors have to be identified in your regional plan and what your first steps or ongoing steps to build these sector strategies have to be outlined and specified. So just a quick step back on the word is really, there's been lots of terminology, industry, sector, clusters, sectors by themselves. So just so you know, a sector really can spread across multiple industries, and industries are defined very specifically, and I'm using the North American makes an industry classification system. So an industry has a very specific definition, but a sector is competing, complementary, or independent firms, interdependent firms. They do business with each other, and they have common needs for talent, technology, and infrastructure. So they're related. So an example of this, just to take you kind of maybe way outside of Illinois for a minute. So Maine, the state of Maine, picture Maine if you've ever been there or just see it as the up in the corner of our country, they have a sector called lumber. So this is really not just the growing of trees, but it's the harvesting of trees. So there's manufacturing companies involved. It's the transporting of the trees. So there's another transportation sector involved. It's really all of the paper mills and all of the other places that this tree goes to turn into some product. So it's not specific industries, but if you think of it as a sector, you can see all of the pieces connected. They share buyers, they share suppliers, they share processes and technology. And most specifically for us, employer businesses that are in a shared sector, they tap into the same skill of workers with the same set of skill needs and the same knowledge base. So organizing a sector strategy allows us to build down to very specific list skill requirements and then to use that really to expand into our into our and align into our training and our service delivery. So an easy way of thinking about how these get organized, this is only one of the methods, but we take a look at what sectors are really spurring economic growth or have the opportunity to spur economic growth, and they're rich in jobs, and you look for this overlap. And this is way back when in the late, maybe 2008, 2009, when clusters is a terminology. But it just gives you an idea. And then, and I want to use this idea and this this kind of example of where we are here to talk about the fact that this is a strategy around emphasis. We're going to emphasize businesses in certain sectors because of the key impact they have in your economy in Northwest Central Illinois, actually in your economic development region 6. But it's not exclusivity. So it doesn't mean that if employers that are not in your targeted sectors do not receive services from the public workforce development system. However, maybe the sector strategies you're using really help you help them even more specifically. So it's not saying no to groups of employers that aren't in these sectors. It's an emphasis strategy, not an exclusivity strategy. So I just wanted to make sure people were clear that that's what is included in the discussion when sectors are built. So I just want to just really jump way back down. There's two versions of slides where I like to talk about the practical applications in a center related to staff and customers coming in when you have sort of sector strategies in the background and the sector strategies have been moved forward and progressed and they now really are creating very specific solutions in a one-stop center in Illinois. And again, some of this already exists. This is just looking at a macro level. So when you target sectors, you can end up with very unique strategies and interventions based on needs. And you may also have seen this. I'm thinking about how far back this slide goes in relationship to Greg. But so here we have on the left-hand column, we have the types of strategies. And here I'm talking about what we do as a workforce development system. So the partners do recruitment and they do job matching and they do pre-employment training and development of workers. We do basic skills training in one partner. We have the capacity, especially in Northwest Central Illinois, to do the, you know, soft skills training. I know you have a training program that you use even in with employers for fee. Occupational training, customized training, on-the-job training, and see work-based training here because these four on the bottom are really under the class called work-based training. So we have these, and we say, well, what customized training might we need this year? And we have 10% of our board funds to set aside to do that. If we're going to do customized training, what will we do? Well, maybe we would think that our tourism sector really has a problem with a high turnover of entry-level workers, and nobody stays in their job long enough to become a supervisor. So most of our tourism hospitality sector say they really have a shortage of middle management. So maybe if we're thinking sectors, so here's an example of three, these two on the outside do specifically apply, and I know this is one of your secondary sectors. What is our possibility for strategy, and what specifically might we want to invest in? So if we were going to do a very specific basic skills targeted to sectors, in addition to the general adult basic education program of citizenship and GED, what might we do more in a more targeted way? Well, if you've ever talked to any manufacturers, they have persistent, for decades now, issues around hiring, typically related to minimum math requirements. And employers, when they're growing fast in particular and they're hiring kind of larger numbers, or for example they're starting adding a new shift to their production line and they have kind of a jump in hiring, they typically pull in a large number of individuals, and one of the recruiting processes is a math test, and they'll tell you that significant numbers of people don't pass the math test. Just a quick aside, when this is the case for manufacturers in your region, I would hope that your business connector role would tell employers, if you are running a math test with any group of recruits, and people don't pass the math test, could you refer the individuals that didn't pass the math test to us? Because if the one thing, not getting them a good job in your targeted sector called manufacturing, is they need a brush up on math, then maybe you could get that reverse referral, I'm using air quotes for that term, from employers. And maybe what you need in Northwest Central Illinois, and I think we've talked about this example before, I think Pam's already given me some feedback on it, is a class called Math for Manufacturing. And it's a basic skills class, very targeted to the math skills refresher, brush up, or, you know, a little bit of the geometry that you might need to pass a test and to be successful as a worker in the manufacturing sector. So I'm just slowing down to give you a couple examples of how you could see your entire training program or a very significant part of your training program aligned very specifically with the needs of employers in key sectors in your economy. So this is the driver. What are the sectors? What are their needs related to talent? And what do we need? So the manufacturing sector needs some help with the pipeline. It needs math for manufacturing. And needs a fair amount of work-based training to keep people retained and advancing on the job. This sector, most of the stuff happens pre-employment. They need lots of referrals because they have a lot of high turnover. They definitely need a customer service certificate training program for pre-employment. We could figure out there are ways to do that. We need to make sure that our soft skills training include working in teams and then some work-based training here. So I just wanted to take this big word called sector strategies and this project called sector strategies that is going to be, you know, people are going to be sick of the term before they ever see maybe really a practical application. But this is what it looks like when you align a sector strategy all the way down to the frontline service delivery level. So enough said on that. Let me just do a little bit more. I like to tell boards, I think I told Pam this, career pathways are also a very featured strategy within the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act. Excuse me. Just taking a sip of my iced tea there. The opposite of a career pathway is a talent pipeline. Now, there's two kind of approaches and distinctions between how you would deploy them and develop them, but I would think that business service representatives would want to call, you know, have any reference, even when it's not technically true in terms of your developmental processes, is that when you're referring to a strategy called career pathways, which is how individuals through a combination of work experience, ongoing education and training, and wraparound support services, move from job to job across a pathway, career ladders, career lattices, we've had all kinds of terminology. But that you would really want to use the word talent pipeline when you're talking about the strategy. And the main distinction between the two is talent pipelines ask employers, where do you get your workers from? So when you are hiring a middle management job, where do you get your workers from? When you're hiring your entry-level job or closer to entry-level job, where do you get your workers from? And most of the hiring is job to job. Most of the hiring in an economy happens where a worker goes from one employer to another without any interruption called unemployment or any stopping to go to school. So it's another really key way to learn about how employers are going down a path of hiring in order to find, in terms of directional, in order to find their workers. And my favorite example of this is when I heard a bank, a human resource manager at a bank saying, well, I always go to McDonald's and I eye the cashiers, and I'm looking for, you know, from cashiers in the retail or the tourism industry. So this is where an entry-level worker in one industry moves to another industry for advancement. So it's no longer career ladders. It's a lot more career lattices, and it's really now career pathways. But if you're talking about this strategy from a business representative perspective, we need to think about it as a talent pipeline. And this is just simply flipping the strategy on its side and making sure that while you're building pathways and you're understanding the data, the occupational data about how individuals use skills to transfer from one job to another and advance, you can also use the really practical data from employers around where employers get their workers from when they're hiring into their company. So again, two strategies. I wanted to just do a semantic thing, but have you really thinking about when you're working on a sector strategy and if you're affiliated with Career Pathways, that you think about both of these opportunities to collect and process data around the movement of workers, because both are really good sources for it. Okay, so I am going to pause for a minute, just ask folks for any feedback, any questions. That's really kind of the bulk of, before we talk about work-based training, really the bulk of the strategy around WIOA I wanted to talk about. Any questions, comments, clarification? Sector strategy?
Melanie, this is Pam, and once again, I'm Joni. I'm using her computer, so I have been on listening. I'm just wondering, when you're talking about like the McDonald's cashiers, I'm wondering if that wouldn't also be a good source for some of our seasonal customer service in our retail and tourism business. You know, I'm thinking in terms of not just the whole cashier, the money handling, but customer service and something like
exactly.
that. And I know I know Lisa's on here, and I know one of the groups or the businesses that are hiring and are looking for individuals are the retailers, the tourism retailers. And I'm just thinking, you know, maybe there's a potential there to develop something.
I would say absolutely. I would say absolutely. I like the practical application you had for that, Pam. And the question is, when employers are looking for hires, where do they go? So it's not just – so the common – this is a perfect example. The common public workforce development sector question is, how do we help these part-time workers in retail get a better job, right?
Right.
The same version of the quest, the same version of the question, which I was suggesting and you just posed, is what employers could gain from the skills and the experience that these part-time seasonal workers have after a part-time seasonal job. It's if you went there automatically, it's making sure you're thinking about the movement of workers from both the business perspective and from the pretty classic public workforce development government perspective. But yeah, I would say that answering that question and pursuing that question would give you a short-term first step for seasonal part-time workers into full-time jobs on some particular pipeline if you address it from the employer perspective.
Yeah, I know we're getting kind of late into the season now, but maybe there's still some time to maybe even develop something for the remainder of the summer and then even carry that into like the Christmas season, the holiday season or something too.
Right.
So
right.
I just think that's something we might want to hang on to for something in the near future.
It's a fabulous
I had that experience recently, Pam. I was at Eagle Ridge Resort and had excellent customer service from one of the servers who we brought on 10 hours a week to do some business interviews, and it turns out she has a marketing and PR degree from Southern Illinois. So her skills are better than what she was able to do in her serving job, and so she's moving up with our organization. So that's great news for us, but now we have to figure out how do we have a larger supply to feed those people who are moving up the chain, because our tourism industry is actually using visas to bring in workers because they just can't find enough talent in that entry-level position.
Exactly.
And I think, Lisa, we also talked at our last employer engagement committee that maybe we need to look at different populations, some of our targeted populations as well. And I think that's something that we still want to do. So.
Great. Right. So it's talking to retailers and saying, we want, let me just go back. I just feel like this is a really good example. It's talking to retailers who have high turnover needs and people who don't stay long enough to be a supervisor. This is actually real data. And customer service is the key skill. So it's talking to retailers and saying, we will create more entry-level workers, youth, individuals with disabilities, long-term unemployed, new entrants to the workforce, people transitioning out of prison as long as they don't have any of the, restrictions. We will make sure there's a steady flow referrals of people with customer service, pre-employment training, and working in teams, pre-employment and training, in order to work with you and your current part-time employees to help them advance. So now you're seeing yourself really being involved in workforce development. This is really what it means to have these strategies be powerfully effective. So that was perfect. That was a perfect example, and I thought a really good practical conversation around what these sector strategies can do and mean. What do other folks have? Thoughts, ideas you want to add into the conversation? Do you have math for manufacturing? I swear we talked about this before, Pam. I talk to so many boards, I can't remember who tells me what sometimes.
I honestly don't recall that we do. Maybe somebody out there can help me. I don't think so, but I would almost wonder if we couldn't connect with the community colleges or the adult ed program.
Exactly. So your interagency team with business service reps has a role called business champion, and I remember Diana saying, we're kind of spending a lot of time here. So business champion role, it would be coming back to the office after meeting with a series of manufacturers and saying, there's a fair amount of hiring going on in our manufacturing sector in our region now, and multiple employers are telling me that they have to run twice as many people through the hiring process in order to get enough people that pass the math test. Okay, it's chronic, it's pretty widespread. It's a piece of thinking strategically around a sector, even if it's not connected to a huge sector-wide strategy, to talk to the adult basic education people and say, from all your basic math training programs, can we pull one of those curriculum out, meet with manufacturers, and align the math, basic math refresher or learning or training program, in addition to what you have, customize a version of that so that it's really specific to the manufacturing. And the community college and the adult basic education providers are the perfect partner on that. Okay, excellent. Okay, so let's move on to talking about the business services section of the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act.
Melanie?
Yes.
This is Diana. I don't mean to interrupt. I just wanted to let
that
the office I'm located in, our internet is down. I have the PowerPoint printed off, but you may have to tell me where we are at in it from time to time.
Okay, so just chime in. I am now on slide 7. It says WIOA Business Services. I'm sorry, Pam, but I'm happy to make sure, because you're key to the discussion, I'm happy to make sure you can follow along. So that was a fabulous conversation on sector strategies. I want to drill down to a very specific section of the law and the regulation that talks about business services. And I think this is one of the first times where they called it out distinctly, and they use long lists. And again, this is in the joint rule section. So this section of the legislation is talking to the one-stop system. It is not talking to any particular partner. So your interagency team is perfectly positioned to have the, air quotes again, permission they need to spend time and best resources to developing out more fully a business services strategy without worrying about whether or not these are disallowed costs, because previously many programs had vague interpretations and more or less worry about that issue depending on the monitoring in the state. So the next three slides are just the detail of the list of business services that are included in the legislation and the joint rule. And they treat them in three sections, an A and a B and a C. And A, the section A is in front of you. This is the must list. So certain services must be made available to local employers specific specifically labor exchange, and that terminology is very specific to the employment service. But again, this is in the joint rule. And by labor exchange, they mean all of the activities whereby you have job boards and resumes and job listings, and staff are making matches between a particular job opening and a particular individual, either at an individual level or group level, an online methodology. So they're basically saying you have to have labor exchange activities and labor market information. And for the most part, your significant, strong core program partner, IDES, with their employment service, has a big chunk of this already up and running, and so it's not a new thing. But it's on the must list. The second is you must establish relationships and networks with both small employers and large employers. And what I think, and their intermediaries. So I think what they're saying here is they want you to spread out in a way that has a better return on investment. And by intermediaries, they say, is to really work with associations, the Small Business Administration, the Manufacturers Association, the Retail Association, the Hospitals and Rural America Association, whatever you have that is an organization of businesses that they want you to be having very specific relationships and developing networks with these intermediaries. So if you're connecting to the intermediaries, you will end up having your networks across those large and small employers. So that's a must. I'm sure you could call a lot of what you do now meeting this must, but you might want to give a little bit more careful thought to how do we do more of this and how do we do this in an intentional way. It's not that we get a relationship with large and small employers and intermediaries, but we are intended. And what are the intermediaries in particular that we want to make sure we have a relationship to? So not as a an outcome of what you're doing, but really thinking about it with intent and strategy. And then the third is creating the sector partnership. So again, I think it will be interesting to see, and your interagency team might really want to take a position on what role the business service representatives on your interagency team play in the development of sector partnerships. So this is the must list. Then it goes on to, and this is a specific question listed in the joint rule, and I'm using my mouse here, Diana, you can't see me to do this, but on slide 7 in small type on the bottom, you'll see I give you a specific reference to the numerical section in the joint rule regulation. This is the final rule that came out 2 or 3 weeks ago that talk about this stuff. So I cut and paste it. I'm literally doing the translation. And the question posed, that regulation is written in a question and answer format, is when may a fee be charged for the business services in the subpart? So there is no requirement fee for service be charged. No fee can be charged for this A list, and it's why I am introducing this fee discussion on this slide. These are not services that you can charge a fee for. This is the must list, but it may be charged for the services listed on the next two slides, and that's what I call Group B and Group C services, and that's why I call them Group B and C. I'm just referring back to the specifics in the legislation. So we're going to proceed on two levels. On the next slide, advancing to slide 8, is to talk about a number of issues. First of all, you're probably doing a lot of these services, A. B, you're probably doing a lot of these services and not charging a fee. All that said, this is a perfect point in time to really address a couple of issues. And one is, prior to the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act, with the exception of the Employment Service and IDES, very few programs were intending or, in some cases, allowed to take resources to deliver services. So if you look at it on just an investment strategy, you essentially don't get a lot of money from your federal formula fund to spend on business services. So as you start thinking about expanding business services and really having a robust business service system, if that's the goal, and that's a strategy you want to pursue, then you really have to walk your way down the path of the feasibility of a fee-for-service strategy. So that's all I'm going to say about it. I am a big supporter of it because, again, I think anytime you spend money on businesses, you're essentially taking away either admin money or formula funding money, service delivery money, if you can make the direct connection. But to the extent that your admin money, and especially in the Title I-B programs, already has kind of a lot of tags associated with it, how would you expand if you don't have any resources to do that? So starting on slide 8, moving on to slide 9, there's a list of services that says you can, under the auspices of the board, and as long as it's included in your local plan, you can expand your business services and you can charge a fee. So this is really starting to look like what I would call being the human resource department at the One-Stop Career Center for different, maybe small to medium-sized employers especially. So, and the reason I'm describing it that way is because for the areas that I've worked for in the recent or long-distance past that do have robust business service strategies and very extensive business services lists, and some of them already do charge fees, that's kind of how they see themselves. Is they see themselves as the human resource department for large groups of small to medium-sized employers. So that's just one way to think about it. But you can see, this is when you're customizing the screening. You're taking one individual employer's list of hiring requirements, and you're digging deep into their resumes, and you're looking and reading in the resumes, and you're doing calling the references on the resumes, and you're verifying the data on the resumes, and you're really doing a very much an HR function for an employer, trying to help employers understand the safety laws or the wage and hour laws, or really giving them good workshops and seminars on unemployment insurance and, you know, how to set up your books so you never, you know, fail an unemployment insurance compensation payment when you have to pay your UI taxes. Customized recruitment events, so really getting a list of manufacturing employers or healthcare employers or logistic employers together and getting a list, a very specific list of their hiring needs, and taking that list of hiring needs in advance and going into the One-Stop Center and starting to create prerequisites for how people get to come to this job fair. They have to have the resume. They have to go through a couple workshops that teach them how to interview and how to dress for the job fair. And they have to have certain skills already met on their resume in order to get into this job fair. So it's not a job fair. It's really an event that has a lot of customization. This is really a human resource department. Writing job descriptions and handbooks, performing about, you know, teaching employers how to do performance evaluations, and giving them templates for writing personnel policies, helping them to orient new employees when they hire, teaching them as an employer how to be a good interviewer, what you can and can't say, questions that are legal and illegal, explaining labor laws so they can comply with all of the government requirements. So we're really getting to an allowance here for you guys to become a human resource department for employers that don't have this available to them. And again, this is a list of services that are tailored for specific employers, and it falls under the category maybe charged a fee for service, and may include, by the way, this is not an exhaustive list, but this is an example. And then the second group, C, these are additional allowable employer activities, and we're going back to more of the macro level. So we're less in the human resources field or department as Group C is. And now we're really on customizing the development of sector strategies, customizing assistance for the development of a registered apprenticeship program. I'm a big fan of registered apprenticeship. And all three of your targeted sectors, manufacturing, logistics, and healthcare, there are existing registered apprenticeship training programs in all three of those sectors. Apprenticeship is not like just the business of the building trades. It's not just for, you know, construction workers and electricians anymore. So really bringing in and expanding apprenticeship programs are helping an employer build an apprenticeship program or in a group of employers. Career pathways, you know, going in and really honing out a whole strategy, succession planning, you know, really building them a much more macro level, long-term view of how to manage their HR, doing a lot more than rapid response in terms of managing reduction in force, marketing, you have an allowance here for marketing services. Again, you don't have a lot of money coming out of your typical formula funds for any one of the core programs, but they're saying you can do marketing if you're raising funds. You might be able to use those funds to spend it on this service. And then tax credits. So this is really another list that is really talking about more specifically what is allowable. So I'm not going to, we could talk some about that, but I thought I'd just at least give you maybe section items that your local, your agency team might want to consider if it's something your board is interested in. And I would assume maybe one of the ways to proceed is, we did talk about this in a webinar with your with members of your workforce board in attendance, and the webinar was related to funding, and some of you were probably listened in on that webinar. But I would say there, I don't know on the continuum from totally in support of exploring to interested you are, but the first thing is really for Pam, you and your staff to get at least a green light or yellow light just to explore it. And then I would use the interagency team really to do a couple of things. So, you know, starting with if Wagner-Peiser funds pay for this already, things like job boards, general online distribution of resumes, so emailing a resume that you found, that, you know, none of the, all of the general activities, none of the customized activities can be charged. But you would want to start with both a partner survey and a feasibility study. So what are partners already doing in relationship to business services? And then a feasibility study of whether or not to apply in Northwest Central Illinois. What are the needs of businesses that are not met by other kinds of maybe private sector employment agencies or private sector human resource consulting firms? And then start with that feasibility study. I would definitely, if I were in the interagency group, I would definitely do some online research about what other local areas are charging fees, what they're charging fees for, what the fees are, what the actual dollar amounts are, how they collect the fees, what they do with the fees. So I would definitely find some sister regions about your size that are doing this, and I have a contact that I'm willing to send you. If I just remember, about 10 years ago, I worked with a group in Oregon, and they were making generating enough fee for service activity to hire four full time staff to be on their business services team, and this was 10 years ago. So let me look up and see if I can't find their contact information. I can at least remember where they were and send that off to focus groups with businesses to start testing the idea, audits for expertise and knowledge. I mean, can you provide these HR services with the staff you have, or would your staff need, you know, more extensive training on HR certificates and HR going and becoming HR, truly trained in HR consulting yourself, in order to be different deal cases, income, and so they come in with some kind of requirements attached to them, but certainly not the same as the federal funds, which are formula-driven and restricted in relationship to admin and program. Business services must be reflective in the local plan. So let me just pause and do a quick check-in on folks' thoughts on a couple things. First of all, expanding your business services, really kind of doing more than maybe you are now. What's your thoughts on that? And then any initial thoughts or well-educated thoughts on fee-for-service if you've had some experience?
Well, I'll jump in.
Go ahead.
No, I was just going to jump in and say, suggest to Diana, I know that the Illinois Workforce Partnership is looking to kind of resurrect their business services focus groups. And one of the things we might do is a survey monkey of just even the 22 workforce areas in Illinois and see if any of them are providing fee for services. If so, what kind, the amount, who does it, whether it's the interagency team, whether it's just a Title I group. that might be something that would be helpful to all areas, particularly now that we're starting the whole, kind of the new idea behind core programs, interagency teams, and things like that. So I would just throw that out there.
Yeah, fabulous idea. And I would add to it surveying for an indicator of if you're not doing it now, how likely are you to jump into this in the next 12 months? And then you have some resources. So your interagency team calls three local boards in three other states that are doing fee-for-service, and the folks that you talk to in Central Illinois that are thinking about it call three other ones, and the folks in, you know, Southwest Illinois who are thinking about it. And then you start pooling your capacity to not only keep your current jobs running, but to do some R&D by sharing it across multiple people who are at the initial point or at the similar point in this as you are. How about other folks? That's a fabulous idea, Pam. I love that.
Diane created this wonderful one and a half page matrix for us that shows all the partners and what their services are. Diane, I imagine that you could use that for doing this as well in kind of similar format, so you can see very quickly what services are provided in the checkbox according to what the agency is or organization.
Yeah, this is Joel. Do we know on the other agencies that it would be on our interagency team, which ones are and aren't allowed to do fee-for-service?
So let me just tell you the initial legislatively context answer to that question, Joel. So it's worth a lot more specific pursuing because there can always be a state interpretation that limits or expands this, and there can also be individual programs in education. But this list of business services and the permission to do fee-for-services is covered in the part of the new regulations that are written by the United States Department of Education with the United States Department of Labor. And those two federal agencies are the federal governing body for all four of the core partners. So adult education, vocational rehabilitation, Title I-B, adult dislocated worker and youth, and the IDES employment. That part of the legislation is talking to all four of those state agency heads and state programs at the same time. So they've opened the door to create this. So at this point, and I liked Pam's suggestion of tapping into the IWD partnership to figure this out, it would be to test where the state's going to be on it, because, you know, every state does whatever they want in terms of adding interpretation A and B if they care deeply enough about an issue. So the general answer is the door's been open for all four of those core programs to be involved in a fee-for-service program services to businesses. That's the regulatory answer to the question. But I think that is a good next step for specifically for Illinois. It's a good question. How about other folks? Okay, so I think you have some ideas about ways to go. I would also Pam, don't forget about sort of testing the measure of your board, just having them, you know, we're interested in seeing the research, could be one end of the continuum that they're on. You know, we want you to start this within the next year, and by 2017, we want to start seeing some income. Who knows? So that's another.
Yeah, well, and I think one of our committees, and I'll be honest, I don't remember one offhand, but I think one of our committees does have as one of its responsibilities to either oversee or explore fee-for-service opportunities. So I'll have to take a look at that and see.
Yeah, I think I remember from yesterday's webinar, might be executive committee.
I was thinking executive for sure, but I will check that out. So, yep.
Yeah. So let's talk again. This has been a major theme in the. So I'm moving on. From business services, expanding business services, and exploring fee for services, to another major theme in the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act, related to advancing business services in Northwest Central Illinois, and that's work-based training. Let me just start by saying, each time we talk about it, your board's been very supportive. There's a number of benefits to work-based training, and these benefits are most specifically addressed to the workers in the system for whom the business is the customer, because the benefits to the business are, in general, based on focus group research that I've been either a party to in terms of reporting or a party to in terms of conducting, employers already do a tremendous amount of training. Employers do more training than a combination of all the funds that we put to and all the numbers of people and all of the hours that we do in our publicly funded system. And they prefer work-based training, which is for a number of reasons. It is most specific to the employer and is most specific to the job. It keeps the worker working while they're learning, as opposed to sending them while they're unemployed off to training in a full-time classroom situation where they don't even have a full-time job. So it's an option that keeps the worker in the workforce as opposed to take them out. And for employers who have demand needs and skill shortage of workers, they don't want to say, yeah, well, we've got them off in school training them. They want to say, send them to me and I'll train them, and you get to say, okay, we want to partner with you. And it's a way to leverage funds. So it's a way to take a public investment and very specifically attach it to a private investment and really expand what's going on. So there's a ton of evaluation on work-based training, lots of studies over time. The OJT program within the Adult Dislocated Worker and Youth Programs has been widely studied. And it's all from positive to extraordinarily positive returns. It's a theme in WIA, and there are new ways to expand work-based training, and it really relies on employer engagement. So 42% of employers are having difficulty finding jobs. This is a North American study. It was done by Manpower Group, does one every year. This is just about a year ago now. Their 2016 study is probably about to come out, but they do an annual talent shortage study. 42% of employers are having difficulty finding jobs, and a fair number of employers are addressing this, but some employers aren't doing anything about it. But this just reminds us, that employers have vacancies going vacant, and a job is vacant. It means that it's competing with the employer's capacity to be, you know, as optimized their productivity and their income and generating profits. So let's take a look at this. I just want to kind of give you an example about how thinking about work-based training can be drawn down to typical. Both of these pieces of data are a little bit old because I couldn't find the current ones. But this is from the study of the long-term unemployed, and there are still large numbers of long-term unemployed. They tend to be the largest percentage of unemployed, and this means anybody that has been unemployed 16 weeks or more. So this was a list from IDES in 2014 of the numbers of unemployed people by their percentage. And then over in a different place, in a different piece of data also provided by IDES, is a vacancy study, job vacancy study. So this is a study of online ads as a measure of the demand for certain occupations. And you can see that at the same point in time, the same quarter in time, again, this data is a little old, but the situation isn't that different. There were 13% of long-term unemployed were office administrative support titled people. And in this same quarter, there were 16,000 jobs across the state given for these workers. And item by item, I just went down the list and did a match. So here's unemployed, long-term unemployed workers, and here's the demand for those unemployed workers in Illinois. You can certainly take out by any measure you want some consideration. The jobs might not be where the workers are. But if this is true in our region, you know, what is going on here? And I think one of the main issues is whatever I did in this job, I'm not perfectly suited to this job. And I see work-based training as a really key way to take people with good work histories in jobs in demand and give them just the right amount of training in order to get them hired first and trained specific to a job later. So I just wanted to kind of use some data to raise maybe people's support of really thinking about work-based training as more and more of the investment and more the way you do that. I'm not going to spend too much time on the specific kinds, but a majority of the work-based training opportunities described in the legislation fall soundly under the Title I-B programs, adult dislocated worker needs, that are also included in the vocational rehabilitation program and as possible next steps for youth coming out of the adult basic education program. So this is really, I'm very specifically talking about the flexibility that's been built into the adult dislocated worker and youth programs. But again, there's some other programs that also invest in training. But you can do incumbent worker training, and you always could, but now the legislation allows you to manage that locally. And this is when an employer has a group of workers that need training. So I bought a new production equipment, and I have to train a whole host of workers on this new equipment. That's just an example. And you can use 20% of your local board program funds to support incumbent worker training. And again, every dollar you spend on incumbent worker training leverages dollars from the employer. Transitional jobs have always been around. They've been very significant for folks on welfare, challenged youth. They've been used in programs that help ex-prisoners transition back into the civilian workforce, and now they're really written in for as a possibility for work-based training. Pre-apprenticeship and apprenticeship training programs are featured. They're really a mainstay, and I saw another $60 million coming out of the USDOL to help states and local areas advance their apprenticeship programs. So if you want grant money to come into your area, you're really going to take a look at building the apprenticeship training programs. And this is really a version of everybody working together to either bring an apprenticeship program in or build a customized one in your industry. And then youth work experience, the mandate to do this is a minimum now of 20% of your funds. And it will particularly probably apply to out-of-school youth because they're also a priority population. On-the-job training, they've extended the capacity to pay an increased wage subsidy up to 75%, and your board has taken action to allow that increase. And then customized training is really a sort of a combination of incumbent worker training and OJT, but it's when you build a very specific training program for the purposes of averting layoffs or retaining employment. So they've given you the or there in some of the industries that may be facing restructuring or challenges in terms of being successful. And we already talked about the incumbent worker training program, and there's some language about the employer share. But this is just a brief description of the kind of training available to you. I'm also going to briefly describe this slide. It's another attempt at taking kind of all of this sector strategy and all of these different work-based training programs and opportunities to spend money on work-based training and really tie it back in to the sector strategy. So you do have in your economic development regions manufacturing, healthcare, and logistics as a strategy. So here's the three targeted sectors across the South. And we look at them in two ways. One is, what are their occupations? And the second, and a more specific detailed piece, is what are the skills? Because occupations may be connected, and certainly skills may be connected, but occupations can also go across industries, and the skills you have can help you transfer to different occupations in different sectors as well. So this is just really what is going on with the arrows. So we look at the pathway. An individual starts with something in pre-employment, probably specifically with you, and then we're really focused on retention and advancement. This is the private public sectors, not only our performance measures, but our long-term vision. And then the pathway is what are the entry-level jobs and skills, what are the medium-level job skills, and what are the high-wage jobs and skills. So this is really describing the pathway in relationship to a skill level and a wage level. So when you start to say, what is it that the public sector is going to do pre-employment with emerging workers or the unemployed workers or the individuals that are having really significant barriers to employment. So we're working with that population. We create some pathways. We do some maybe pre-employment training. And then we're advancing them hopefully as quickly as possible across this dotted line so that we're better combining working and learning and combining learning and working together. And maybe we discover, so translating from that slide we were talking about earlier, that we really want to build for an apprenticeship program in our region for the entry-level minimum wage, entry-skill level minimum wage jobs in manufacturing. And then we really want to use our on-the-job training money to advance folks from entry-level skill, entry-level wage jobs to medium-level skill, medium-level wage jobs. And that's where we would make an on-the-job training investment and logistics center. And then we really need to help the healthcare workers get some managers. It's one of the things they talk about. So maybe we'll do some incumbent worker training. So folks with a lot of technical, scientific health skill, health care skills, maybe also begin to learn some management and HR skills. So this is just another way of thinking. How do we take a big umbrella thing called sector strategy and specifically think about it in relationship to work-based training? And then you can start to see what it might specifically mean for the role of the business reps in your area around how it is we really start to see ourselves representing different particular sectors and sector needs more specifically than thinking of the employer and community at large. And really starting to translate that in our business connector role and our business representative role and our business consultant role. So here's some ideas that might get you started or advancing your work with employers on work-based training. Certainly being talking to maybe even a focus group of whatever employers you've done OJTs with as an example in the past, and really having them list their concerns and be clear about their experience with you, and then really addressing those. Certainly one common challenge for even the on-the-job training contracting with employers were the administrative requirements. So finding a way is to start building templates, for example. If you were to create on-the-job training for logistics skills, you'd take 6 or 7 job descriptions and you'd write a template OJT contract. And then really all that's really left then is for the employer to, for the individual to identify the skills they have and us to be specific about what skills are covered by the training contract under that OJT. I'm working with intermediaries. We talked about that before, and really bringing large groups of employers into the understanding and into the opportunities for work-based training. Targeting employers with high numbers of hires for targeted populations or high numbers of hard-to-fill occupations. And I'll show you an example of that in the targeting slide I have coming up. I would start maybe even more simply or more practical, just asking for employers to commit in some way as a work-based training site. So it might be they will start to do tours for youth. That's a version of work-based training way on the kind of the mentoring internship level, that all the way up to being a site really for an on-the-job training contract. So thinking of yourself as doing site development in specific relationship to work-based training is maybe the most practical way. And then under that position development, really starting to think of internships in a more grouped, templated way based on either hard-to-fill jobs or a sector strategy. Just thinking more in a group way than in an individual way about how to address work-based training, and then making sure you have some good champions and some good satisfaction testimonials. Here's what employers are saying about work-based training in Northwest Central Illinois. Okay, any discussion on work-based training?
Melanie?
Yes.
Oh, you can hear me again. I'm sorry. It's Diana.
Yes.
And we lost our internet. I evidently lost my ability to unmute my phone, so I'm sharing a screen and a phone now with Rhonda Kruger.
I'm so sorry.
Well, it's not your fault. We've been having this problem off and on for 3 weeks now.
All right, nice to have you back. So what do people think about work-based training? Any comments, clarifications, questions?
Not really.
So we did talk about it with your workforce board. Pam, any sharing of kind of their take on it that you can give to your interagency team? I think they were very interested and I would say generally supportive. Would you agree?
Yes, absolutely. And again, I know that's something that we've put in both our local and regional plans, so we'll be certainly utilizing that as part of our career pathways. And it's something I think we have been doing a little bit more of lately with even those individuals who are currently in community colleges, where we've been able to kind of link them up with employers for an internship. So I definitely see us doing this much more often and making it a part of pretty much our regular menu of services.
Perfect. Excellent. Well, and I think, again, the macro question is an ongoing building of an understanding and appreciation of sort of your total investment in training and coming down to really starting to figure out, you know, if I got $100,000 to invest in training in Northwest Central Illinois, what percent am I going to use for classroom training and what percent am I going to use for work-based training? And I think I've told this story before, at least during the board webinars, of a Mexico. And way back when the workforce WIA passed, they basically said they wanted 80% of their formula funds for training, for their training dollars to be spent on work-based training for a number of reasons, not the least of which is the more rural the area, the less likely there are a lot of good training options for a lot of the demand occupations. So if we don't even have training for enough training to train enough people for the jobs in demand, then we're going to have to really keep moving toward seeing the employer as the trainer and seeing training as something that happens in combination with work and not doing as much sequencing. I'm working full-time or I'm training full-time and I go back and forth between the two. Okay, so let's just do a quick update on performance measurement related to engaging businesses. Engaging employers, I think, is the way. Employer engagement, that's the actual terminology that they use, that there will be a new measurement on employer engagement. And they've developed some indicators that they think will help us measure employer engagement. Where they've landed is that there's going to be a pilot program to test these three proposed approaches, and out of that have each state choose two of the three approaches to incorporate in their state and start up a program and use to measure, as well as any additional that the governor of the state might want to add. And then they're going to study all of the state's experience across each of the three of these indicators and produce a report toward the end of next year. Based on their evaluation of the state's experience, they are intending to have an implementation of the new employer engagement measure not until program year 2019. So we have a lot of time to kind of get our quote-unquote ducks in a row related to these employer measures. But a good board like you have there in Northwest Central Illinois with MTI Works is going to really be anticipating and really being sensitive to aligning strategy that will help you be successful on any of the three of these, given that all three of them give you a different kind of measure of some kind of engagement with employers. So the three that will be included under an employer engagement measure that will be tested, two per state. One is using, it's kind of a retention measure. Since we're already measuring retention for individuals, they will actually measure if the individual is retained with the same employer in the second quarter as in the fourth quarter. So they're presuming, and I'm using that word very, very globally, that an, someone who's working for an employer in their second quarter after exit and is still working for the same employer their fourth quarter after exit tells us something, and I'm not sure exactly how helpful this one will, and it probably needs a lot more feedback after states test it. The second one that's proposed as an indicator is the repeated use rate for employers of core programs. So of an employer who uses the service in relationship to any of the core programs, so an employer that's connected and uses the service through the adult dislocated worker or youth programs, uses the service through vocational rehabilitation, through the employment service, or through the adult basic education programs, how many of the employers use another service? So not one, but a second. So they're repeating their use of services among any of the core programs. And the third one is kind of it's a loose translation of market share, but the number or percent of all employers that use the core program services compared to all employers in the area. So if you have 1,000 employers and 100 use your service, you would end up with a 10% measure. So these are the three. They're going to go into test mode through states. Each state will test two, and it'll be quite some time before we know the efficacy of any of these three measures. And that's just, I just wanted to do a quick update for folks on that. Any questions or comments on the measure? Any thoughts?
Any what?
Any thoughts? Have you heard these? Do you guys already know what's going on with this or no?
Carrie had shared with me these three. She had been on a webinar. The one that kind of gives me pause is the second one, the repeated use rate for employers' use of core programs. I think that in some rural areas with small businesses, I mean, some of them are very, very, very small, who don't have a lot of turnover, I wonder if that is going to reflect a accurate, I don't know, picture of the relationship that's built.
Well, if you expand your list of services and you're doing things like helping them be good interviewers, no, seriously. I see, at a minimum, the reason I put these three up there is because the question is, how will we succeed no matter which one it is? The biggest challenge for me is, number one, you have the least amount of capacity to say to a current employer, what can we do to help you keep that person employed another half a year? That's how you involve yourself in meeting that first measure. Otherwise, it's random, right? It's just, I don't know, how many people get a job and stay there a year? I'm not sure what it says about you guys at all, and I'm not sure what you would do other than, you know, being very involved in helping an employer retain the worker they hired, and maybe slowing down and making sure the hired worker is a better match. Whatever it is, it's challenging. But I like where you went with that number two. I mean, you'd have to have a lot of service.
A lot.
Mm-hmm. Well, and this is Pam, and I guess my question is, when, what are they going to measure? The repeat number, or are they going to measure the employer that repeats? And is it only one time, or do they have to repeat more than one time in order to be counted? I think there's a lot of that one because, right. You know, if it's just one time, yes, maybe coming up with a second service for employers wouldn't be difficult. But if it's going to be repeated, you know, X percent, and even number of employers, counting the number of employers, I think it's going to be a little tougher.
Right.
But it'll be interesting to see how that one pans out.
Right. Well, let me translate it right back to even work-based training, which is what we were just talking about. The more work-based training you do, the more you're going to meet number two and number three.
So you mean if you have, like, more than one OJT go through the system, would that be a repeat service?
So I don't know the technical details yet. I think there's more data going to be certainly available before they put dates to the test. But the more employers that do work-based training, the more customers you have, which is number three, and it's a secondary use. They're hiring, they're training. I mean, there's all kinds of services embedded. So they're, you know what I mean? It's like there's lots of ways. I think my main point is I think there's ways for you to choose strategy to help you be successful on number two. And number one, I'm not quite sure, but we got time to spend more on that. So we're officially going to go over a few minutes. There are a few more slides I want to make sure I at least share with you, because we're going to move into a little bit on kind of outreach strategy and trip strategy and tips. And if we weren't recording, I think it'd be okay to just wrap up where we are. But since we are making a recording, I at least prefer to get kind of a little bit of at least my take on these tips and strategies for you guys recorded. So if you can stay with us, that's great. And if you have to go, I'm sorry I'm running over, but I did want to slow down and make sure we had some good dialogue. So one of the main outreach tips that I recommend for business services teams, and I think business services teams and individuals on a team do this by virtue of their work experience in the job, so that everybody has kind of some kind of strategy for deciding what employers they're going to work with. Oftentimes that's based on the job seekers I'm working with. I have a person who used to be a pallet driver in front of me. They want a new job. I'm going to talk to an employer that hires pallet drivers. So I think there's certain ways that drive us in terms of our contact with employers. And when we step back and just look at the employer market specifically, and we ask ourselves, you know, can you serve all employers? The answer is no. Even the interagency team combining all of their staff time, you would not be able to provide services to all employers who might benefit from your services in your local area or in your region. So that said, the question becomes, what is the mechanism and the strategy and the criteria that we use in order to make sure we're defining the employers that we want to work with to a certain extent? And this is not saying no to anybody. This is who do we really want as customers, and it's sort of how much yes. So any employer who calls gets a yes, but some employers might get a bigger yes. So if I'm investing public funds in a work-based training program, what kind of business, and there's some regulatory answer to this, but what kind of business might I put that investment in? And you might have policy that says the majority of our work-based training invested dollars will go into, for example, employers in our three primary sectors. So it's a way to start using strategy to answer the question, who are our customers, with a comma, who do we want our customers to be? So targeting helps you maximize your limited resources. Not employers have equal needs, so you don't want all employers to be your customers anyway. It allows you to really intensify and get more expertise on serving some of the businesses and maybe maintaining a generalist for other kinds of businesses. And it helps create synergy across partners. Targeting strategies can definitely be shared. So focus on strategically defined customers. This group of employers who are not currently customers, we want to be our customers. That's what targeting means. You make that decision strategically, and you allocate your resources in order to make that happen. You gain knowledge and expertise in the industry, and then you really start targeting your services and customizing them in general to that market. So, for example, you could target employers who hire large numbers of hardest jobs to fill. This, again, is from that Manpower Group survey that I told you about. Perennially, these jobs are on the list. In North America, this is not either a state, this is actually a U.S. list. This is not a state list or a regional list or a local list, but I know anybody who's working with businesses in your area will look at this list and say, yep, it has some applicability here. So perhaps what we want to do is really work with employers who are hiring any of these jobs, because these jobs are the hardest to These employers are more likely to have vacancies longer, are more likely to be willing probably to do work-based training strategies, are more likely to work with you to have you help find a pretty good match, because they're in the position of having a hard time filling the job. So I think that's just one way, a very generalized way of thinking about what employers do we want to work with. And I think you'll see most employers, many of the employers in your three sector targets have these staff, have these occupations and are trying to fill these occupations. So it's just an example of targeting. I think another example of targeting, and we've seen this this slide before from in another webinar, but there's a kind of study called the Job Vacancy Report, and it's a way of looking at what employers are hiring for, or what employers say they have vacancies for, and marshaling that in a way that tells you something significant by analyzing the data. So your state has contracted with a nationally renowned conference that does what's called Help Wanted Online, and they take a look at all the online advertising for jobs, and out of the contract you get regional reports. So I went online for June 2016. Here's the website here. It's listed and it's linked in the PowerPoints. And I selected your region and this month, and I asked for, so I'm talking about this whole section here. So two things come up on the report. Here are the online job ads by number. So these are the top, this is the list that have 100 or more jobs advertised. If it's a one for one count, I think Al was pointing out some employers kind of are just recruiting for an in-house talent bank. They want to start building their resumes for when they're hiring. So it might not be actual jobs, but they're expressing some kind of demand by using this number, or some kind of difficulty by using a higher number. So any job that 100 or more online job ads in June in the Northwest region, I cut and paste those here. And then they also produce a list of employers with the most openings. So if I'm targeting employers, I'm going to look for employers hiring for these occupations. And you will see, by the way, this is almost an exact match. I'm going to go back to this list. You almost have the same sort of demand for hiring going on as the list of the hardest to fill jobs. So this might not just be demand. This might also be a good comparison to the hardest to fill jobs. And here's the employers with the jobs. So I would maybe target employers that hire these occupations, and I would certainly use this list of hiring employers as a way to do some very specific outreach. And this list, this data is produced monthly. So if you've not seen this before, you're going to want to go to this site and bookmark it. And monthly, just pull down a list so you can see over time the trends about what's going on. People are using this. I know Al said he was using this. Are other people on this call familiar with this list, and do you use it, and for what applications?
I have never used it.
I really didn't know that it existed until you had presented it on one of the board webinars.
Yeah, I think it was right. Work-based learning, maybe.
Yes.
Right. So this is just another way of getting very targeted about the answer to the question of who, if we were to describe our business customer list, what criteria will we use to put businesses on that list? And here's and that is our target. This is just another source of data to start generally at least doing some targeting. I'm assuming people know these employers, and I'm assuming you're probably already working with some of these employers, but maybe you're not, and maybe the hospital only calls you for CNAs, and you discover the hospital also has IT job vacancies, and entry-level cafeteria workers, and et cetera, et cetera. So the other thing here is these hiring companies are probably hiring for multiple occupations and might know you as only a resource for entry-level workers or as a resource for people who just got their CNA credentials out of a training program. So again, it's just a way to sort of target. And then the second thing I wanted to just do an initial overview on is an account management strategy, and that's really in addition to targeting employers by some method of criteria, to also start building in standardized processing and standardized operating among yourselves and your interagency group that says that business customers will start to be handled as business accounts. So it's a way to build in your goal of building a relationship with an employer into a strategy by seeing them as an account and managing them as an account. So we take a one-time an employer and we consider some criteria and we say, do we want to grow our business with this customer? And if the answer is yes, how will we build in an account management strategy, assign staff, assign resources, and assign some kind of sequential list of activities in order to build them as an account and not just as a customer. So it's the difference between a customer and a partner, and it's right in the middle by treating them as an account. It brings emphasis to you for specific businesses in the community. This kind of system can be shared across your whole interagency group. So we share an account management strategy together, and however we decide to manage accounts, it's the difference between saying, I was in one office once, and I said, you know, how do you guys decide who calls on what employers? And they said it's alphabetical. Well, that is a methodology, but I'm not sure it's a strategy. You know, you take A through L, and I'll take M through P, and someone takes, you know, Q through Z or whatever. It is a way to take the employer market and divvy it up among different staff, but again, it's not maybe necessarily strategic. A more strategic way might be, you know, Mary and Jim and Jane, why don't you guys target the manufacturing sector, and Fred and Phil and Lois, why don't you take the healthcare sector? So now we're starting to take the entire market and see them as customers that might require within the customer base some management, and then you could share that across your whole system. And that's what the staffing is. You can broker different kinds of services. You can represent that sector for everybody. So when I go to the manufacturing companies, I'm representing all of my partners as opposed to each of you competing. And then it really helps you organize a marketing strategy. So I'm going to just quickly, and maybe you've seen this before, I spent too much time on this. Have you seen this from anything from Greg Newton has done?
I have not. Neither have I.
So let me give you enough information to consider this strategy. So, you know, if you know me well enough, you know, I see things in connections and I see things in groups. So one account management model as an example, and this is the one that I've developed very fully and I do tons of training on, and it makes the most sense to me in terms of a combination of good strategy and pretty easy to use. So there's three account levels. So this is taking the employer accounts and thinking of some of them as basic level customers, intermediate level customers, and top level customers. And this could be like we did in Louisiana. It was bronze, silver, and gold, for an example. So there's taking the entire market and saying there's three levels of customers who might become accounts: basic accounts, intermediate accounts, and premier accounts. Based on their account, then we associate the level of service. So anybody who's a basic customer, we would promote and create direct connect access to the basic services. So if you remember that list of services a couple of pages ago, this would be what was ever on Group A: labor exchange, ability to participate in sector strategies, that kind of thing. I'm actually going to just stop for a minute to mute the phones. We're getting a little bit of feedback. intermediate customers could have access to basic services, but we would also promote our customized services to intermediate accounts. And then there's enhanced training services, and then they're on our premier account. So what you need, and then the method featured, basic customers, basic level customers who have access to basic services. We facilitate and we feature self-help. So we teach employers how to put jobs into a job bank. We teach employers how to search the resumes in the job bank. But we really, we marshal our staff time and our staff resources toward the higher level accounts. The group and self-help would be a featured method of service delivery for intermediate. So lots of seminars, lots of targeted and customized job fairs, which also have, and self-help. And then the premier accounts really, we reserve our staff time and an investment of your expertise and one-on-one services for premier customers. And this model, let me get my advanced impact, is really aligned now with what's coming out of WIOA in terms of the way they list their services. So essentially what you need is a method to assign account levels, and I'm going to give you the elevator speech on this, and it's probably enough for, if you're interested, for you guys to move forward with it. So in this model, and when I train on it, and when I train on a group's capacity to adopt it, I say imagine you create a 10-point system, and each of the criteria in that 10-point system is worth 1 point. And the criteria is, if we're defining customers that we want to work with, what would be on this list? So let's say employers who hire a certain number of workers every year, 10 or more. That's item number one on the list, it's equal to 1 point. We want to work with employers who have career advancement from inside the company. That's number two on the list, it's worth 1 point. We want to work with employers who have tuition reimbursement programs. Number three on the list, it's worth 1 point. We want to work with employers in our sectors. We want to work with employers who pay wages a dime above minimum wage for most of their, whatever, I'm making it up. So you can see yourself creating this list of 10 criteria. Each of the criteria is worth 1 point. And then you come back and you say, let's take this list of 10 points and apply it to a customer. And any employers who only get three or less points on that list, they are a basic account, or can be a basic account if they're not a current customer. If they get 4 to 7 points on the 1 to 7 points on the list, they're an intermediate account. If they get, you know, 8 or more points on the list, they're a premier account. And that's just the simplest way to start thinking about taking the 60,000 employers in your region or the 20,000 employers in your local area, and starting to think about them in a more strategic way, especially as it lends itself to account management. And then out of that, you get, out of having or adopting an account management model, you get all kinds of additional strategies that flow from making that model. So the first thing is you take the list of employers in your area and what you know about them, and you just start saying, well, I talked to, you know, Jane over at Company X yesterday, and from what I know about that company and this list of 10 criteria is usually pretty easily, it's pretty known factors. It's not something you'd have to survey on. She would be a basic account. I have three pink phone call messages on my desk, and they all need a call back today. It's at the end of the day, and I can only call one of these employer back today. And I looked at the three names of employers, and I see one employer just in my mind. If I was thinking about an account management model, I'd say, well, this employer's, I've never talked to them before. If they were a customer, they'd be a premier account. And these other two phone calls came from basic accounts. I'm going to call all three of them back. I'm just going to call this employer back first. So again, it's an emphasis strategy. It's not exclusive. So you start by thinking that way. And then you take the list of businesses in your area, and you separate the current customers from the potential customers. These are customers especially that we don't want to lose. These are customers that we want, and these are customers that we really have to potentially lean toward more self-service or teach, you know, not spend as much time, invest as much staff time down here as down here, so that we have time to actually develop new customers, but specifically by a list of names. So we take the list of all the employers in the region or in the local area, depending on how you're going to flush this out. You're going to have names of customers, names of companies in these boxes. And you're going to know who it is if you're doing, air quotes again, something called sales. This is the way you take the list. You start here and start here. And these maybe aren't people you do sales calls on. And then from that, here's how the services and the methodology build out. So employers down here, we feature self-service, and they have immediate access to the basic services, and that's all we promote. Employers here, we treat more in groups, but we get customized and basic services. And up here, we're doing really the one-on-one enhanced. And then you also develop your marketing strategy. These are the flyers, and these are the ads, and these are the things that any employer might see because it reaches everybody, but it really only promotes your basic service. And then we do target marketing in this group of employers, and then we really do very specific one-on-one, almost boutique attaches up here. So this is just a full-day training, really just consolidated into giving you a recommendation and maybe some ways to think about getting more strategic about how you approach the whole business market and starting to make some decisions about how to unbundle that market and look at that market in different ways of separation. These three levels and at least current and potential is really where you would start with this. Okay, that was super duper fast, but hopefully it's enough to get you thinking about additional ways to organize your work, especially across your interagency team, and then maybe really moving more to what I would use the term marketing for, which is much more comprehensive strategy like is on this slide. Okay, I'm going to stop talking. I'm going to give you guys the floor. Any quick questions, clarifications? Was that way too fast to make any sense at all, but or did I give you enough to at least see what I'm talking about and get you interested in maybe exploring it? Just give me some feedback, folks. Oops, sorry. I might have you all on mute. Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm sorry. I asked a question.
Okay.
And I had you on mute.
It's Diana. Your overview of the account management strategy, I really like that, and I think that's something that, you know, we could possibly further develop with our partners on the interagency team so that we're more coordinated. We've had a lot of changes over the last, 12 years that we've been in existence, a lot of staff changes. And I think this would probably help provide a new cohesiveness and coordination. Some of the partners come from really out of our region, to provide services, and I think this would allow us to identify and plan who's contacting whom and how to pass the baton for different services. Exactly. I really like this account management strategy.
Right. Well, and I do think it would give you continuity. I mean, once you're running it in, a new person could come in and, you know, understand we have what we're going to give you in your role. Some opportunity to reach out to intermediate accounts. Here's the list. Here's why we want those as customers. I think the strategy lends itself to continuity across all kinds of staff changes and frequencies across programs. Yeah. Excellent. What are other people saying?
Well, this is Pam, and actually, Diana, this is very similar to what we talked about probably a year or so ago, when we talked about having the employer forums and then giving them, like, options, you know,
yeah.
Package one,
package
two,
mm-hmm.
and triage packages and, like, what was in each package. I think this better organizes it. And I also see this as something that we could utilize to going back to the performance measures, like the repeat
yeah.
customers. You
yeah,
know,
yeah.
you could move from the basic accounts to the intermediate accounts. There you've got your repeat customers, and you address that performance measure. So I really like this. Very organized.
Well, and I think there's a bunch of questions that come out of this. So a slight variation on what you said, Pam, is that I don't want to offer basic accounts. These are employers who might not be paying good wages, don't have tuition reimbursement, don't promote from within. They don't have any enough of the criteria on your 10-point scale that you identified to make them a good investment, to make them a good place to send a worker who you think is going to get retention and stay there and be able to advance on that job. So it's not that the job isn't good and the employer isn't good, but we're talking more strategically. So you wouldn't offer basic accounts, OJTs, for example. That's a very stretched out way of putting an illustration. You'd only offer OJTs to premier accounts.
Right.
So it's not, what package of service do you want? It's, here's the package of service we've all organized for you because we'd like to consider you a premier account. That's the conversation you have to potential customers in this little piece. You know, you don't want all of your staff calling on basic accounts who only hire 5 people a year. You want your staff calling on 10 employers who hire 50 people a year. And I'm not necessarily making it an either or. I'm just saying you decide up front how this works, and you leave it less up to the will or discretion or the request of the employer. So everybody
right.
gets a yes, just how much yes. Yeah, I'm probably stressing that. But it's the reverse of offering an employer a whole, you never write a whole brochure that says here's everything we do. Or if you have a brochure that says here's everything we do, these are the only people you show it to. You don't want these people asking for something that would be a very big investment beyond the possible return. Okay.
Right,
other
but
people,
if we're looking at them as potential customers, we might also offer them as something like maybe the basic HR services, helping them with job descriptions or I don't know, training packets or something. But yeah, okay.
I even see that work-based learning could actually fall on a continuum of this pyramid. Like maybe the basic accounts would be appropriate for job shadowing and maybe transitional jobs, and then work experience to your intermediate and OJT and incumbent worker. Well, I'm not going to say incumbent worker
tour,
only, but
tours and internships and OJT. Yeah, perfect.
Yeah.
That's a perfect example. So literally now you just can start thinking this way without adopting anything on the page. So let's say you do an annual job fair, and it's a big deal, and every year everybody works really hard on it, and you end up with 40 employers in the room, and it's a big room. Which employers get a booth at the front door where all the traffic will see them? Now, many people call that booth number one, and the first employer that said yes gets assigned booth number one, and the second employer gets booth number two. All right, that's one way of assigning them. But you would probably take 10 premier accounts and promise them booths at the front door where 180 people are going to pass through in the next 4 hours. See, just thinking this way will take you farther even if you don't do anything more formally to adopt it. So it's just being more strategic about the way you invest and the way you advance business services in your area. All right, Cheryl, Sally, Paige, Teresa, Lisa, Rhonda, Joel, any comments? We're about to wrap up, so any comments on the account management model or any comments overall on the webinar?
No, just trying to digest it all.
Yeah, this was definitely a lot. I definitely threw this. This really is, you can tell, it's an all-day training, but I think as we were just saying, as Diana was responding, it's even a way just to start thinking differently about the way you organize your work. So it's at least got that to it. Overall, the webinar was good for you, Joel?
Yes.
Okay. Rhonda, are you there, Cindy?
Good information. I like the idea about the job fair, about putting the people in the right spot.
Perfect. Sally, Lisa, what do you guys think?
I thought it was really good information.
With Cindy.
Right. All right, so I'm leaving.
It makes you think with other brain.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Because I'm the career guy. So it makes me think with the other brain.
Perfect. And then someone else said something?
The visual model helps you understand the concept quickly.
Yeah. You can tell I've been working on this slide for, it's been this way for a number of years, but it's definitely evolved over the years of my work and training on the model. Okay, so I'm going to sign off. We did go at least almost a half an hour over, but I hope it was worth your time. It was hard to not do a little section on outreach and marketing, at least give you some ideas on that. And then the rest was really very strategic or technical updates a point in time kind of webinar. So, all right, it was a pleasure working with you guys. I will at least send you a couple of leads for some fee-for-service customers that fee-for-service local areas that I know about. And if I can give you any additional information, you guys know how to get in touch with me. So thanks very much.
Thanks, Melanie.
Thank you very much, Melanie.
Take care.
Take care.